moving on to month two, we're going to tackle artificial sweeteners, sugar, and fruit. And our task for this month is to eliminate sugar and artificial sweeteners and instead eat lots of fruit. Now, for some patients, this can be a fairly challenging goal because they really have a sweet tooth and find it very difficult to give up sugar entirely. There's other people out there who really don't have much of a sweet tooth. There's really a huge amount of variation between our taste for sugar. If you are one of those people who has a strong taste for sugar and feels like this is going to be very challenging, then there's hope for you. We're going to recognize that sugar is an addiction, and by using a few tricks, we can get you to break that addiction. So sugar consumption is increasing dramatically. If we look back to in the pre-World War I days, Americans ate somewhere between 30 to 50 grams of sugar, which is about the sugar that you'll get just from eating fruits and vegetables that contain natural sugar. Get into the 70s, we're at about 75 grams. In the 90s, early 90s, mid 90s, we're 110 grams. In 2010, we're up to 200 grams, and that's continuing to increase. We eat a tremendous amount of sugar, and we are becoming addicted to it. Sugar triggers the same pleasure centers in your brain as drugs, alcohol, and tobacco. And what we also find is that some of the drugs that we can use that will actually block narcotics and street drugs like heroin will also reduce your cravings and decrease the pleasure you get from sugar. And this is one thing that I use in my office a ton, is a medication called naltrexone. There's a drug called Narcan, which is an injectable form that the EMS and the emergency room doctors will use if someone comes in with a narcotic overdose, either from for prescription painkillers or street drugs. And you can inject this Narcan into someone's vein, and literally within seconds, it'll block the drug from working, and the patients will wake up immediately. It's actually, if you have ever seen that, it's an incredibly dramatic reaction and really gives you a huge appreciation for the effect of the drug. Now, naltrexone is in pill form, and it doesn't work as immediately. It works over the long run. And when I work with patients who are really struggling with sugar addiction, it's never my first line agent, but I'll use that drug. It's actually part of a combination medication. You can use it with the second pill, Wellbutrin, alone. And I do discuss this in more detail in one of the other videos where we talk about weight loss medications. So what we see when we look at the impact of sugar on animals is that you can get rats to become completely addicted to sugary liquids, to the point where they will continue to consume it, become significantly obese, even suffer from malnutrition, and just continue to drink this sugary liquid. And we also see this in children. Children are particularly susceptible to the effects of sugar. And to understand why we're so hooked on sugar as a society, and especially kids, you have to recognize where this preference came from. Why do we like sugar so much? What's unique about it that makes it so special and so addictive? Well, it turns out that our preference for sugar is actually an evolutionary advantage. At least it was 10,000, 20,000 years ago. Because there is no natural substance on this planet that is poisonous but also contains fructose, or one half of table sugar, but essentially sugar. So as when we were cave people and depended primarily on foraging our food, the sugar, the intelligence that was required in order to make sure that you picked the right foods and didn't pick poisonous or toxic foods was very difficult to learn, and it was something passed on from generation to generation and taught to our children. And what we see was that children kind of picked up on this quickly. We all know that children typically are picky eaters and don't like to eat a lot of different foods. And a lot of that goes back to our evolutionary heritage, because if children went out there and were like, oh, let me try this, let me try that, let's try all these different foods, they're going to suffer from poisoning because they're smaller and they're more susceptible and they don't have that intelligence, that knowledge of which berry is this red berry or that red berry that I can eat. One will kill you, the other will nourish you. And so children were susceptible to this, so they just would narrow their food choices and would have this strong desire for sugar because it was a marker for a food that was safe to eat. And it turns out that this was a real symbiotic relationship, because when we ate the fruit that contained the sugar, the seeds would pass through us and then we would spread them around, so it would help the plant grow and flourish as well. So we're really fighting evolution and biology here when we're trying to tackle this sweet addiction. So we have to, you know, when you're faced with that kind of challenge, you have to do it smart. So sugar tolerance is really the big issue. Our goal is not to eliminate sugar from your diet, because fruit is good and we're going to eat tons of fruit. What we have to recognize is that when you eat artificial sweeteners and refined sugar, you find that you become more and more tolerant of the sugar, and it takes more or sweeter foods in order to satisfy the same pleasure centers in our brain. And as we develop this addiction, it just goes, ramps up and up and up. And so what we have to do is reset our taste buds back down to the sugar level of fruit. That's our goal here. And we can do that, and it doesn't take as long as you think, and it's not as hard as you think. So the first thing that to recognize is that sugar is everywhere. Yogurt. I used to give grocery store tours, and I would have, you know, 10 or 15 people with me walking through a grocery store, and I would say, okay, we're one of these fancy grocery stores, and there was probably 15 different types of yogurt that they had available for sale. And I would tell everybody, all right, I want you guys all to go out and to see if you can find me a strawberry flavored yogurt that does not contain sugar. And they would go back and they'd all be reading the labels and checking it out. Oh, no, this one has, you know, it doesn't say sugar, but it's pure cane juice, and kind of recognizing all the other words for sugar that you can find. And they would come back to me after a few minutes and say, you know what? They all have sugar in them. And I still have yet to find one. If you know of one, please let us know. I'd love to see. But the vast majority of yogurt that's out there contains added sugar. And that's not just the lactose that's in the yogurt naturally. That means that the manufacturers are adding sugar to the yogurt. Another thing is, you gotta look at anything that's a tomato product, like pasta sauce or ketchup, tends to have a lot of sugar. Really good quality tomatoes will have a sweetness to them. Poor quality tomatoes, less so. So you can use poor quality tomatoes to make this, add a little sugar, and you get the taste of good quality tomatoes. Granola bars and a lot of cereals that are labeled as healthy are loaded with sugar. A lot of salad dressings, especially ones that have a tomato base. And a lot of the sauces in Chinese food have a ton of sugar in them. So to get rid of the sugar, you really have to start playing detective and be a little bit careful with this, because it's out there. I often get questions in my office about other forms of sugar, more natural sugars, whether it's coconut sugar or honey or agave. And the truth is, they're all sugars. And there's a little bit of leeway here, particularly with agave and with honey. Coconut sugar is really just sugar that comes from coconuts instead of beets or sugarcane. But agave and honey are a little more natural form, and there are some benefits, particularly to honey. And I do think that a little bit of honey in your diet in food is okay, but honey in a beverage is not okay. And I'll go over that, the reason why that's important, in just a second. There's a lot of talk about high fructose corn syrup versus regular sugar. The truth is, they're the same. They should be considered the same. One's not worse than the other. They're both terrible, and our goal is to eliminate both of them as much as possible. So now let's talk about the very worst way that you can consume sugar, and that's as soda pop. And it's become a daily part of our diet, where back in the 50s and 60s, soda pop was kind of like a Friday night thing. It was a special thing. But now it's come down to the point where there's a lot of people out there who drink a six-pack of full sugar soda every day. We've seen a doubling in the consumption from 1977 to 2002, and it's continued to increase from there. Now, there's a lot of science out there trying to link certain foods to obesity. And so the epidemiologists and the nutritionists do offer nutritional surveys, and then they try to link and say, hey, if you eat a lot of potato chips, that means that you're more likely to be overweight. Turns out when you look at 99% of the foods out there, you can't statistically link them to obesity. By isolating a single food, we can't say, but that one food, that's the thing that causes you to gain a lot of weight. And there's one exception to that, and that's soda pop. Regular consumers of soda pop are much more likely to be obese, and I'm talking about full sugar soda pop. It's actually true for diet pop as well, but it's a stronger correlation for full sugar soda pop. If you consume soda pop, you will be, on average, heavier than someone who does not. And the more you consume, the heavier you get. So this food is unique in its ability to cause weight gain. And if you have any hope whatsoever of succeeding at weight loss, you must eliminate these from your diet. So let's talk about why sugar-sweetened beverages are so much worse for you than sugar in other forms. Because cookies and cakes aren't nearly as linked, and I'm not aware of any strong evidence that directly points to sweet foods as being linked to obesity the way we have with soda pop. So what happens is, as we've discussed, our body has this metabolic thermostat that helps to regulate our weight. And what happens is, if I'm about to sit down for dinner, and before dinner, I sit and I have a 150 calorie cookie, and we always tell our kids, you know, you're gonna ruin your dinner by eating this cookie. And it's because we acknowledge the fact that if you eat a cookie with 150 calories, when you sit down to dinner, that's 150 calories less that you're likely to consume. Because our thermostat understands the calories in a cookie. It understands a solid food. And it's going to regulate and decrease our appetite. We all know this from our own experiences. If you're hungry and you eat a cookie, you actually are less hungry. It's certainly not your best choice, but it does impact your appetite. Sugar-sweetened beverages don't do that. Our body has two things that we keep track of. One is hunger, the other is thirst. So when we eat a cookie, it helps to satisfy our hunger. So if we're usually gonna get to here after a meal, that's only this much more food we're gonna eat to get up to that point where we would normally stop eating. The problem is when you drink sugar, it doesn't register in the hunger category. It registers in the thirst category. So just like we're working to regulate the amount of food we're eating, we're also working to regulate our fluid status. And thirst is a primary mechanism that's used to cause us to go out and get more fluid, to drink more fluid, to help restore the amount of fluid we have in our body. So what happens is when you drink a pop for 150 calories, your body doesn't know that there's 150 calories in it. It just makes you less thirsty. It does not make you less hungry. So it's not gonna regulate. So if you drink that pop before dinner, you're going to end up still eating the same amount. Instead of eating just this amount, you'll eat the whole amount when you sit down for dinner, and those 150 calories from the pop, they go right around this regulatory mechanism we have to maintain our body weight. And they're much more likely to be stored as fat than calories that we consume in any other form. So, how do you get rid of soda pop? The truth is, it's really easy, as long as you do one critical thing, and that's you must replace the caffeine. Most soda pop consumers drink pop with caffeine. Not all, but I found the vast majority do. And they're completely and totally addicted to caffeine, as am I. I am completely addicted to caffeine. Most Americans are. It's okay. Taking in caffeine really hasn't been linked to anything all that bad. And every now and then you'll see one study that says, oh, it's a carcinogen or something along those lines. But then there's an equal amount of studies saying the opposite. There's nothing that's directly correlated caffeine intake to any significant health problems. And from a weight loss perspective, it may actually be helpful. So we don't have to get rid of the caffeine. The caffeine's not the issue. Instead, we got to get rid of the sugar sweetened beverage. So we just have to replace the caffeine. And we do that by one of several ways. We can drink caffeinated water, unsweetened iced tea, coffee, black coffee, or I often have patients take an Excedrin, or you can even purchase caffeine pills. So we have to get the caffeine. Now coffee, most people say, I can't drink coffee without artificial sweeteners or real sugar in it. And I understand that. I also can't drink inexpensive, poor quality coffee without something else in it to cut the taste. So if you're gonna go and get Maxwell House or Folgers and try to drink that black, good luck. If you can do it, fantastic, more power to you. But most of us can't. What you have to do is become a little bit of a coffee connoisseur. Now, I'm not saying you gotta buy the $30 a pound coffee from Hawaii. You just have to, instead of spending maybe $4 or $5 for a pound of coffee, get up to the $7, $8, $9 range. Overall, this is going to cost you less than $10 a month. Plus, we're not going to be using the sugar, the creamer, the artificial sweetener. So it's not going to be a particularly expensive change for you. But find the right coffee shop. Try it out. Go to a coffee shop. Talk to someone who really knows about coffee. Start to learn the difference between an espresso roast and a French roast. And recognize that there are some really delicious coffees that you can drink black without any sweetener at all. So that's a great way to get out to allow you to start drinking coffee without having to add anything else to it. Now, it's not just about soda pop. Sugar sweetened beverages are everywhere. Gatorade, it really infuriates me that Gatorade is sold as this performance enhancing beverage. It's not, it's sugar water. And to think that you should drink it when you work out, especially when most people who are working out on a regular basis in this country have some goals of maintaining leanness. To look at Gatorade as a way to fuel your workout or to somehow replenish electrolytes is really just foolish. This stuff should be completely avoided. It's a sugar sweetened beverage the same as Coca-Cola. It's just like drinking Coca-Cola after your workout instead of Gatorade. A lot of the energy drinks, again, getting us hooked on this caffeine rush, Monster, Red Bull, things like that, loaded with sugar. Fruit juice, as we're gonna talk about a little bit later, loaded with sugar. Not that different from Coca-Cola and other soda pops. So we have to eliminate fruit juice, all of it, even the all-natural fruit juice. Lemonade and sweet tea, it's all out there. Most of these have caffeine in. These two have caffeine, the others typically don't. I wouldn't be surprised if they start adding caffeine to some of the sports drinks though. But they have caffeine in, and so again, that same strategy. If you're hooked on these beverages, we gotta find a different way to replace the caffeine. Now, I get a lot of questions. You know, doc, I'm drinking a lot of pop, but I hear the diet pop is even worse for you. That's not true. It's absolutely not true. It's scientifically not true. The full sugar pop is the absolute worst thing you can drink. Now, diet pop is not good for you. It's not okay, but it is not nearly as fattening and does not have the same rates of diabetes and high blood pressure and heart disease that we see from full sugar pop. So our goal is to get off both of them, but please don't go around telling people that the diet pop is even worse than the full sugar pop. So let's switch gears and now start to talk about artificial sweeteners. If we're gonna get rid of the sugar, we also have to get rid of the artificial sweeteners. Now, why is it so important for us to get rid of artificial sweeteners? Because they don't have any calories, so they must be free, correct? And the truth is, no, that's not correct. And we're seeing links between artificial sweetener consumption and diabetes and obesity. And we're recognizing, again, it's not this simple balancing of calories in to calories out. This is about your metabolic thermostat and how it works to regulate your appetite, to regulate your hunger, and to address and maintain a healthy physiologic weight. So artificial sweeteners are addictive, just like real sugar. Again, they're triggering these pleasure centers in our brain, and causing us to seek more and more of them. And in fact, they're the sweetest of all foods out there. Artificial sweeteners are sometimes 100 times, ounce for ounce, more sweet than real sugar. So we really have this spectrum of fruit to sugar to artificial sweeteners. So we have no hope of getting rid of the sugar if we don't also get rid of the artificial sweeteners. We've got to retrain our taste buds to work in this range of sweetness. And after a week or two, after you get rid of the sugar and the artificial sweeteners, what you're going to find is that fruit is going to taste so much sweeter. And I have patients all the time come in and say, Dr. Weiner, have you tasted the peaches this year? Oh my God, they are amazing. And I have, of course, tasted the peaches this year, and they're good. They're like every other year. I wouldn't say it's a particularly good year. And it's because they've gotten the sugar and the artificial sweeteners out so they can really truly appreciate the sweet taste of fruit. And what you'll find is as you eliminate the processed and refined sugar and sweeteners, fruit becomes delicious and you're able to enjoy it so much more. So let's talk about how artificial sweeteners cause weight gain and why they're dangerous. Now, this metabolic thermostat that we have that works to regulate our appetite and helps to balance the calories that we consume to the calories that we burn by adjusting our appetite and adjusting our metabolism is heavily affected by artificial sweeteners. So what happens is when you consume artificial sweeteners, it triggers the sweet taste buds in our mouth, but also we have taste buds in our intestines as well. And they're there for a reason. They're there so that your brain and your fat and your liver can all get a sense of what type of food is coming through. So it can adjust. Are we going to need insulin because there's a high sugar content? Are we going to need some of the enzymes that help break down and process fat because there's a high fat content? So these artificial sweeteners are going to trigger the sweet taste buds in our mouth and in our intestines. And what happens is it's going to say to your pancreas, hey, get ready, ramp up the insulin because some sugar is coming. We got some carbohydrate coming down the pike and we're going to need you because we're going to need to process this carbohydrate because sugar means carbohydrate to our brain because artificial sweeteners are not real and we didn't evolve with them. We don't understand them. They're a foreign concept. A sweet taste without calories, without carbohydrate, that doesn't exist in nature. So what happens is that our pancreas ramps up the insulin, but the carbohydrate never comes. So all of these changes are going through to our gut, trying to adjust for this increased carbohydrate load, which never comes. So over time, after it's kind of been fooled, this becomes like the boy who cried wolf. And ultimately, your pancreas stops reacting and stops adjusting to the carbohydrate load, and the metabolic thermostat, which works to regulate your appetite and match your calories that you burn and the calories that you consume to each other, stops working as well, particularly when it comes to sugar. So we're going to consume sugar even in fruits and vegetables. Again, you're going to get 50 grams just from the fruits and vegetables we eat. So what happens is if you regularly consume artificial sweeteners, it makes even fruit fattening because the sugar in fruit is not going to be processed and handled the way it normally is. And the refined sugar we eat is going to be that much more fattening than it normally is. So because of that, we have to let our body adjust and work with the food that it was designed to metabolize, which is fruit, the sugar that it understands and knows and can handle. So also, one of the most common questions I get about artificial sweeteners, when I talk about it, they say, you know, but you're not talking about stevia, right? Stevia is totally natural. And I always comment and say, you use stevia, right? Yeah. What's it look like? It's a white powder. Have you ever seen a white powder in nature? A white powder doesn't exist in nature. Stevia is processed. Just like sugar, a white powder, is processed from sugar canes or from beets, stevia is processed from the stevia plant. Just because it's natural doesn't make it healthy. Remember, tobacco is 100% natural. It doesn't make it a healthy option. We have very limited long-term data about stevia, and there's some studies out there that show that it may promote cancer growth. The other artificial sweeteners, the aspartame or NutraSweet, the sucralose or Splenda, and the saccharin or Sweet'n'Low. These sweeteners have been around for decades and decades and been consumed by the tons. And we've looked at them and studied them. I don't think they cause cancer. They cause other issues like we've talked about. But as far as them being putting you at increased risk for cancer or any other adverse health event, we have a lot of evidence that says they're not that bad. Stevia is new. For me, I'm very distrusting of anything new that's coming down the pipeline because we don't have the long-term data. People haven't been consuming refined stevia for a prolonged period of time. And again, stevia, like other sweeteners, it's not as sweet as the other ones, but it still causes taste adaptation and prevents you from enjoying fruit and from being able to consume fruit and satisfy that sweet taste. And it has all those same changes on your intestines because there's no carbohydrate along with the stevia. So alternatives to artificial sweeteners are fruit. Something that I really enjoy is an iced tea maker, and I'll purchase herbal tea, which now comes in pretty much every variety you can imagine. And I'll make iced herbal tea, which is absolutely delicious and can be used by those people who consume a lot of, say, Diet Red Bull or Crystal Light or anything like that. Also, the diffusers where you cut up slices of oranges or cucumbers or lemons or limes and let them sit in the water for a few days work well. And again, the caffeinated water down here, also excellent for anyone who's hooked on a product that contains artificial sweeteners and caffeine, and you want to maintain your caffeine intake so you can get rid of the artificial sweeteners. So now let's move on and talk about fruit. The number one comment I hear about fruit is that it's high in sugar, right? Well, I can't eat bananas. Bananas are really high in sugar, so I should avoid those at least, right? No, you can eat all fruit. And when we look at the amount of sugar and the impact on your nutrition, we find that there's such a huge difference. Look at a banana versus a banana split. We've got 14 grams versus 73 grams of sugar. Orange versus an orange Julius. Seven times as much sugar in an orange Julius as there is in an orange, and twice as much in cherry pie compared to cherries. We must draw our battle lines appropriately. Just like last month, we didn't eliminate the frozen vegetables, the non-organic vegetables, even the canned vegetables. We're not going to eliminate the fruit. What we have to get rid of is the banana split, not the banana. Get rid of the ice cream and the refined sugar. So yes, fruit does have sugar, but it does not nearly have as much sugar as the refined sugar products do. So then people say, well, I think you're going to gain a lot of weight from fruit. However, what we find when we look at studies that show what people eat and how much they weigh, that increased fruit intake prevents weight gain. It prevents high blood pressure. It prevents diabetes. It prevents heart disease. It prevents stroke. I even saw a study where they had some women take a picture of their kitchen, and women who had a fruit bowl out in their kitchen ended up being on average leaner than women who did not have a fruit bowl. Just the mere act of having a fruit bowl in your kitchen was associated with leanness, let alone consuming more fruit. Of course, we all know if you have a fruit bowl out, you're much more likely to eat fruit than if it's stuck away in the refrigerator. We also see a direct dosage relationship. The more fruit you eat, the thinner you are. So again, no, does fruit cause weight gain? It does not. I'm not aware of a single study where you separate fruit from fruit juice. Now, there's some studies that show that people who consume fruit, but they actually include fruit juice along with fruit, that show a trend toward weight gain. But as we'll see, fruit juice is a sugar sweetened beverage. And I'm not aware of any study where it's just fruit that says that it causes weight gain. So sometimes diabetics will say, yeah, but I'm diabetic, doc, so I really can't do sugar. First thing I always respond to that is, does fruit increase your sugar the same way a bagel does? No. Well, do you ever eat bagels? Every now and then, or some form of bread? Yes, I do. So fruit is gonna increase your sugar way less. So it actually would be better for you to switch to fruit. The second is that when we look at the study, we see that fruit intake in diabetics actually lowers your average blood sugar level, because it's not just about the total carb count. It's about the fiber and the phytonutrients that come along with that sugar that's in fruit that actually works to lower your blood sugar. We also see that increased fruit consumption decreases the incidence of complications of diabetes, like diabetic retinopathy or eye disease. And in fact, increasing your increased intake of fruit decreases your chance of ever developing diabetes. So the science does not in any way support the intake of fruit being linked to obesity, being linked to diabetes, or being bad for patients who are diabetic. So what about fruit juice? Fruit juice is okay as long as it's all natural, right? Wrong. Fruit juice works the opposite of whole fruit. It is a sugar-sweetened beverage. It's probably not quite as bad as soda pop, but it's in the same category where soda pop is 100% bad, fruit juice may be 85% bad. It's still something we absolutely must avoid. And the science out there shows that increased fruit juice increases your risk of diabetes, increases your risk of obesity, increases your risk of heart disease, and increases your risk of stroke. So fruit juice is not the same as fruit. And it's because when we take that orange and we run it through the juicer, we're spitting out the pulp. We're spitting out the phytonutrients. We're spitting out the fiber, when that's the stuff that we really need. That's what's making the fruit healthy. When we look at fruit juice versus soda pop, it's almost the same amount of sugar. It's really just a little bit better. It's not something that is an acceptable part of your diet. And if you want to lose weight, eliminating fruit juice is critical. Well, what about smoothies? They're kind of like fruit juice, right? Yes, but with one critical difference. When you take that orange and you stick it in a blender to make a smoothie, there's no pulp, there's no waste. All the phytonutrients, all the fiber are in that smoothie. Now, some people argue that the mechanical whirring of the blender will disrupt the fiber and make it less healthy, and who knows, maybe they're right. I'm not aware of strong science proving that, but I think we're splitting hairs on that. So smoothies are great because we're not extracting the pulp. There's no waste. We're eating the whole orange. It's disrupted mechanically, but nutritiously, we haven't removed a substance from it. So you can eat as much fruit as you like. It's going to satisfy your sweet cravings. There's no scientific evidence that it's unhealthy, and we're going to try to incorporate smoothies as our breakfast. So that concludes our discussion of artificial sweeteners, sugar, and fruit. We're going to move on to month three, where we're going to tackle junk food and learn about the values of adding nuts to your diet.